subscribe to our YouTube channel and press the bell icon to get the latest updates.
The headline of this week's National Interest seems to suggest that it says it all, that strewn by the rivers of the heartland and across the Vindhyas lies evidence of the politics that sucks and politics that works. Now, you might say, oh, all right, we know what you are getting at. But that is not just that, because National Interest, I have to make an argument over 1200 words. And here it is. So you see these stories, corpses floating down the Ganga and Yamuna, so many of them, literally hundreds of them, maybe a couple of thousand, we don't know the count, shallow buried or merely strewn on the river banks in COVID-stricken Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. These will remain the abiding images of the pandemic, not just in India, but in worldwide. I know it's very embarrassing, it's a national shame, but it's a reality. And this is what's going on right now in our country, in the Hindi heartland. For us in India, it is the indicator of something else. It's not just an indicator of the fact that people are poor or that there is religion involved or ethnicity or maybe region, nothing. And it's not the fault of the rivers. Because for us in India, it does not just mean a pandemic wave that comes and goes taking lakhs in its sweep, but a perpetual tragedy of poor governance, underdevelopment, lousy politics, and also, most importantly, frightful regional imbalances. So let me talk about this in some detail. Uttar Pradesh and Bihar are by no means the only states in India where great rivers flow. Besides Ganga and Yamuna, we also have Brahmaputra, Krishna, Kaveri, Godavari, Narmada. We also have Satluj, Ravi, Bias in Punjab. Punjab actually has the highest fatality rate, case fatality rate for COVID anywhere in India, almost 7 to 8 times as high as, say, in Kerala, which has the lowest. And yet in Punjab, in the rivers of Punjab, you don't find bodies floating, nor do in all these other great rivers. So it is not the fault of the rivers. All the great rivers of our country are revered as mothers, Godavari Ma, Narmada Ma. It's not just Ganga and Yamuna. All of these are given some kind of a manifestation of divine motherhood. And by and large, the similar religious demographics also prevail in all these regions and states. So if not religion, if not the region, what is it? Because it can't also be the region, because the same Yamuna on the one side has Uttar Pradesh, on the one side has Haryana. In Haryana, you don't see the same phenomenon taking place, but you do see in Uttar Pradesh. So is it then to do with language, culture, or that last but the most defenseless of all usual suspects when those in power run out of alibis and scapegoats? The people. Blame the people. But, you know, you never blame the people, not unless you are that character from Sacha Baron Cohen's Borat series, you know who I am talking about. So you don't blame the people, because you can't elect a new people, your people are a given. So what or who do we blame then? Why is it so that people only in some states are so poor, desperate, hopeless as to be dumping the bodies of those so loved by them into rivers, unable to afford the dignity of last rites, a bit of wood, a pyre, a proper burial in a burial ground? Why can't they do it? So two things are responsible, because we've ruled out all the other possibilities, ethnicity, religion, region, tradition, and people. And those two possibilities are politics and economics. And the order I choose for these is deliberate, because in a democracy, all economics is a consequence of politics. Politics does not flow for economics. Economics flows from politics, which takes us into our familiar ground, which is politics. Take not just UP and Bihar, but all the four states of Hindi heartland. So add also Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh. This is what for decades has been described as Bimaru states. Unkind, brutal, but not untrue. Because that is what the social indicators of these states tell us. Now, these four states are the Hindi heartland state. The Hindi heartland in India is also the political heartland of India. Now, for simplicity of analysis, we are also looking at these states as these were before the smaller states, Uttarakhand, Jharkhand, and Chhattisgarh were carved out, because they are part of the same political, linguistic landmass. So we are letting them be there. So economically, they have much in common, the most important of which is that all these four states remain under the threshold of $1,500 per month per capita income. That is way below the national average of about $2,200. So it is that way behind, that far behind the national average, this entire region. Most of the holiest ancient shrines of Hinduism are also located in this region. Badrinath, Kedarnath, Mathura, Kashi, Varanasi, Ujjain, Mahakal, so many of them. And yet, while it might be the home of Hindutva politics today, don't blame Hindutva politics for all of the problems of the region, because until recently is as in until 1989, this was the unassailable fort of Congress politics. Congress ruled the region and Congress ruled the country. In fact, every Indian Prime Minister who was the dominant leader of their parties came from Uttar Pradesh. That is Jawaharlal Nehru, Indira Gandhi, Rajiv Gandhi, B.P. Singh, Chandrasekhar, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, and now even Narendra Modi. He comes from Gujarat, but he shifted to Varanasi because he also knows that you have to draw your power from the Hindi heartland. We are excluding Morarji Desai, Narasimha Rao and Manmohan Singh for obvious reasons, and we are not even counting Devegowda and Gujral, etc., because they were not really leaders of their parties. They were compromise candidates or running weak minority governments, as in the case of Narasimha Rao. Now, Hindi heartland decides who rules India, on that there is no doubt. Yet, it is also the poorest, most shambolically governed, with social indicators so lousy, they drag down all of India. These range from literacy to infant mortality to school dropout rate, life expectancy, per capita incomes, and birth rates. In fact, we had published a story in 2018, and I will share a link with you with the description of this video, that showed how Uttar Pradesh has almost exactly the same size of population as Pakistan, say about 23 crores, and yet it has social indicators which are about the same as Pakistan's, which are way below India's national social indicators, except one where it is way behind even Pakistan, that is per capita income. So that is what tells you, that is what illustrates for us our heartland problem, whether or not the description of Bimaru states is fair or not, but this is the reality. Now look at these four states. UP, Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, Rajasthan. None of the four feature among the top 20 of India's states and union territories by per capita income. Not even top 20. So they were not in. They are not in the top half. In fact, the first one to feature in India's rankings is Rajasthan at 22, and after that we have Madhya Pradesh at 27. UP at 32, and Bihar brings up the very end, the very rear at 33. In fact, if you throw in some more union territories, etc., it will still be the last. Bihar has a per capita income of $640 compared, say, to Goa's $6,600. But if you say Goa is a very small state, then look at India's average per capita income of $2,200. So Bihar is still almost one-fourth or little less than one-fourth of India's national average. It is that poor. On the other hand, look at the population growth charts. There, these states are top of the pops. So where they need to be at the bottom, they are at the top. Where any state wants to be at the top, they are at the bottom. So on population growth, Bihar topped India in 2011 census. That's the only decent or authentic information we have available, because rest is projections. Projections actually will make it worse for these states, but let's look at 2011 census. Bihar had 25% population growth between 2001 and 11 and topped India on the wrong scale. followed by Rajasthan, MP and UP, all in the 2021 range. In comparison, in the same 10 years, Kerala grew by 4.9%. That is less than 5%. South of the Vindhyas, therefore, the picture changes. If you look at all your states south of the Vindhyas, Goa, Telangana, Karnataka, Kerala, Puducherry, Andhra, Tamil Nadu, Gujarat. These are national ranks 1, that is Goa, in per capita incomes, and ranks 6 to 12, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, between all the rest of them. And then Maharashtra comes at 15 and Andhra comes at 17. So all these states of the South and Union Territories feature in the top 20 of Indian rankings, Indian states rankings, by way of income, whereas none of these four heartland states feature there. I told you the first one is Rajasthan at 22. So that is the big contrast. Again, translate this into politics, which is what we are coming at. And that's the reason I said this headline tells you, it teases you, but doesn't tell you the full story. So the full story is this. You translate this into politics. The four Bimaru states account for 204 seats out of the Lok Sabha's 543, right? When a party sweeps them, as the BJP has done under Modi and Congress used to do until 1984, that party is guaranteed power in Delhi. So you have to win this miserable heartland to rule India, to get power over all the states, including states south of the Vindhyas, to rule all of them if you sweep these four states of the heartland. Because Lok Sabha has 543, this is 204, you get 180, 190 seats there. Then 180, 190 is the new 272. We've been saying that for a long time now. All these states south of the Vindhyas, with little Puducherry, Andamans, Lakshadweep also thrown in, only add up to 185 seats. Now, not for the heck of it, but just to create a likes for likes comparison, also because we are looking at south of Vindhyas, so let's also throw in Odisha there. So if you throw in Odisha, it becomes 205 seats. So 205 here and 204 there. But look at the politics of these states. Is it at all possible for any party or coalition in the foreseeable future to sweep all these states and get 160, 70, 80, 90, 195 seats out of these? It is not possible. It does not look possible in the foreseeable future. Nobody can say anything is impossible forever. So there is very little chance that these states will be able to determine who rules India. Now, this is the paradox, the great paradox of Indian politics and Indian quality of life. The states which closely share their political and preferences languish at the bottom of the quality of life scales, even when they rule India, that is Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, Rajasthan. They share their political preferences and they pay for it. So they suffer, they have the poorest quality of life anywhere in India. This was so under the Congress and this continues to be so under the BJP. So we are not blaming this government only, we are blaming the politics of these states. So what do politicians tell these states? You give me power in the name of religion, caste, nationalism, and I give you such misery that you will have to go for a living 1,000 miles away to work as a laborer in Bombay or Delhi or Bangalore or Hyderabad, live in a slum, suffer, and then also when the pandemic comes and twice a year, you will have to flee for your home completely miserable. And I will leave you so miserable that in the middle of a pandemic, you will have no money to give your parents, sibling, child, anybody you love, dignified last rites, and you will be left to throw their bodies in the rivers. Whereas you will give me this gift of power over all of India. South of Vindhyas, each state has its own politics. Most have their own regional leaders. They give them decent governance, deliver welfare efficiently, raise income levels, as also social indicators, build industries, create jobs. So the leaders they vote for, they don't leave them to their fate and they don't leave them to throw the bodies of their own family members into the rivers. Some of these leaders might be corrupt, but they govern competently because their voters make their choices based on their performance, not just identity. Remember, I said not just identity. So identity does matter in the south also, or south of the Vindhyas also. It matters in Maharashtra, it matters in Goa, it matters in Gujarat, it matters in Tamil Nadu, it matters in Andhra, Telangana, everywhere. Identity matters everywhere. But in these states, people don't vote just on identity. They have other considerations too, because politics is more competitive internally there. Because each have their own politics, they count for so little in Delhi. If you look at the Modi cabinet today, the senior most members of the, from the south, that is S. Jaishankar, foreign minister, Nirmala Sitharaman, finance minister, very powerful ministers, they are both Rajya Sabhaites with no real roots in the south. In fact, at the senior level, the only leader I see from the south with some roots in the south is the vice president, Venkaiah Naidu. None else. This kind of regional imbalance in political power, economic and social indicators is deeply troublesome. Already the slowest rising populations in India, six of the slowest, are in this region. In 1951, the composition of our 543 member Lok Sabha was determined by state population then. That gap between the states and now it has now increased massively, because some states have allowed their populations to explode. Some states have been able to control them simply by raising their social indicators, not by any laws. In 1951, for example, UP's population, including Uttarakhand, was twice Tamil Nadu's, and it was allocated about twice this Lok Sabha seats as Tamil Nadu then. Today, it is three times of Tamil Nadu's, and this gap is increasing. And you will soon know the reason I am raising these points. In 1951, Bihar's population, including Jharkhand, was over twice Kerala's. So it was given 54 seats and Kerala was given 20. Today, it's more than four times Kerala's and the gap is increasing. Now, there is a sizable political can of worms, closed can of worms, which we are kicking down the road. That is delimitation. How long does India continue with the parliament with the same size, with the same allocation of seats to these states? So in 2001, too, some constitutional amendments were passed. So as I said, this can was kicked down the road, and these amendments said in 2026, we'll take a call and we might constitute our Lok Sabha depending on the findings of the first census to be held after 2026, which might be 2031. If these are the population trends, then you know what will happen to national parliament then. And then you also know what kind of instability will it cause between the progressive, better governed southern states and the poorly governed Hindi heartland states. Because the southern states, the better governed states, would then say we are being punished for just governing ourselves better, for getting our social indicators better, getting our population under control. So this will lead to a very disruptive and a very problematic situation. So once again, in conclusion, if poor governance means higher population, because poorer your governance, more babies your people produce, which means more political power, then India is being navigated into a maelstrom, a bad situation. The bodies in the Yamuna and Ganga are like canaries in that political coal mine, albeit they are frightfully silent. They don't sing like usual canaries.